jumping.
Slowly started. There's a pinkish, purplish twilight dawn, and light orange blue sky.
I'm looking.
Now under this look, you remember what was? The lotus was slowly. Beautiful. Imagine the forest very quiet. Let's all sit very quietly like the forest. Let's imagine we are all trees in the forest. Let's see how all of you sit straight, quietly. Very good. Now, in this pond, on this leaf, below the leaf. Now listen. Below the leaf, there was. Something which has eight legs.
Octopus.
Spider. Very good. There was this spider who was weaving a what?
Web.
Where?
Under the shoulder.
And he was watching.
animals, their sounds and many things.
Okay.
Even models in it were very good, like we should love plants and even the children's participation was involved, that what happened there, what would have happened.
Okay.
So, and that also, it was even, you know, keeping them very attentive, just because their involvement also was there.
It's the same
one.
Yeah,
it's
the same
one.
The one used to do a lot of gestures. It was not like that, he was standing still and you were telling.
Right.
He used to do the gestures, you were making the
sound,
sounding the cries of the animals. So, it was very lively.
Okay.
And they were also interested.
Not have an appreciation for nature. For instance, if you just tell him, you know, when the sun rises, there is amazing stillness, the child is not going to feel that. But if you can bring it in the story very subtly, and I could see, you know, if you were in front, that when I was talking about the sunrise, their eyes were like actually saying orange and some of them were saying yellow, pink. You know, it was coming out of their mouths. So I think we underestimate that the child cannot appreciate what the adults can. And it is very important that we also bring an environment which very subtly gets into the system of the child. So tomorrow when he looks at a plant, or maybe he would love to respect.
So there is a lot of oral, definitely storytelling is a great job. I mean, it is not easy for everyone to express those feelings and emotions in front of students, basically in front of child. So I think that it was very creative and innovative ideas, and the students were able to relate themselves with the story.
Yes.
Basically, they were very much involvement was there. How they can feel that, oh, how the lion was and the spider was weaving the web and all that. So it was basically interesting and innovative, and they could relate themselves to the story. And for me, I felt that expressions matter a lot, definitely. And whatever story you are telling, and for that, it is expressionless. Hold the attention of the students if you are moving along with the story and with the expressions and all those. So basically it holds the concentration of the students. And lastly, whatever you want to narrate the story, the whole moral of the story you can take it out from the students itself. Okay, what was the moral of the story?
So did you think
basically if they are paying attention, so what they understood about the story, if the students are not able to understand what we were narrating or what we were telling, so this was, if we would find out what is the moral of the story, it's cool. I mean, if just we talked about the environment, why environment is important for us, how they can talk to, are the plants sensitive, are animals sensitive, do they react when we talk to them.
When you're narrating a story, then very important voice model is facial expression, eye movement. Children can involve in this.
For me, I've always seen the teachers telling story with the, either with the books or the flashcards. But this was something very new method where we have nothing to use like flashcards or a storybook, and a good method to involve the children.
So you don't need a mask.
Yeah. And expressions and more of like introducing some sounds to the animals. We can tell a story. Very boring method to always like snake does this and that.
Okay. I think that you create all that jungle scene and the sequence of the story in front of our eyes. And you are totally engrossed with your verbal things and with your body language. That it was fantastic. The one thing I like was that you gave them the choice, like they do leave and this. That means, and you started with the
no
asking the questions. Yes. So that was, and the voice modulation vocabulary was there,
right,
you know,
right.
Under, below, like
yes,
the,
yes.
The children below, under, yes. Up, down. And the language was, you know, language. And for the, suppose for the lion, you used so many adjectives like huge, big, majestic. So, you know.
They also learn.
Yeah, they also learn words.
But it was not delicate. He
told almost all the things. One thing I want to add it, that was a link between everything. Like that was beautifully linked. It was not abstract like this is, this will be happen. It was from the children's viewpoint and it was totally linked by the nature, like with the nature itself. Like who can the last in the mosquito, they brought it that way, and the spider. So, which can, I was thinking, you must bring it that frog, that can also catch this thing. But then I was thinking, then you did wave and then did the gesture, then it came out like that was beautifully linked with the nature, like who can hold
with your own self to the story.
I found that, see, being a teacher, when sometimes we are telling a story, we just want to finish a story. Or actually we are planned. And we are more self-centered rather than observing children. And I generally, whenever a teacher tells a story, I observe children. And they are just like no expression, sitting or waiting. Okay, okay, puri, so now going. Or okay, fine, what is the moral? And being a teacher, I've seen the teacher component, you know, we are very greedy of children should know a lot many things. So when we say our vocabulary, this, that, they are very happy. But what I feel most important is the fun part. They should enjoy. When we say it's a joyful learning, when you enjoy your learning, and gradually, like itna hisab ke tak nahi karna hai ki, oh good, huh? So then, you know, the, sometimes, you know, while this, what teacher carry impression is, whenever I tell a story, our children should learn lot many things. The east, west, sunset, the color description, the jungle, the vocabulary. And then artificially, if you try to put all these things in your story, I think somewhere it'll become, you're away from the enjoyment of the story. I feel that no, first that if we are set as a storyteller, if we have a harmony with the story, then our flow becomes very naturally,
it
goes, right? And my another observation is I like the moment. Many times we have a voice modulation or thing, but I like your, how the lion really walk, you know? Or how the mosquito's movement is. So we make a sound sometime, we show the plant, but movement we are not very comfortable, and I'm sure we are not much aware about, we don't talk whenever we talk about animals, the movement. We talk about food, we talk about shelter, what of informations we talk. That part I like. Another most beautiful part, what is the crying need of today's time, is concentration. Children, you just see, they are not able to sit, but still, that your flow was so catchy, but they were little like this, but they were engrossed in your
song.
Yeah, yes. And then look at the minute, how many minutes they were able to sit and listening, right? And I like another way that when children are reacting. When you say lion entry, it should be like, huh? Like that. When quiet, So that is.
They were just reflecting.
Yeah. And I found that okay, your harmony with yourself, you're able to transfer that to children. And that was wonderful, you know. What I'm feeling, if I'm able to create the same feeling in my audience, I think it's a great task and it's a great challenge to a teacher performance, you know. Right? So, excellent. We are very happy.
I did not know what story I was going to tell, because audience are new. I wanted to also see if they were receptive to a story which is a little complicated, or not all fourth standards in all places are the same. You know, there is a difference. I felt that these fourth standard children seated here were very innocent, which I liked very much. There was an innocence about them, and it was not like a very urban elite child. Because I have seen children coming from very elite schools, and they come and say, okay, what story are you going to tell? So, I have seen even third standard children coming and saying, no, you're going to tell a story, but it's only for kids. No, so it was important for me to know what kind of audience it is. When I saw them seated, and when I saw them looking up to me with that eyes, I said, ah, now I know what story I'm going to tell. Because there was a certain innocence, which was like almost the first or second standard. That was the first thing. The second thing is that now that these children are open and ready to take my story, let me tell something which they can relate to. I was actually thinking of telling a story about a lady who flies with her balloons. Okay? And another story I was thinking of is about how birds got its colors. And the third story I was thinking of is a person who lives in different kinds of houses. And another story which I was thinking of was the giving tree. Because one thing I noticed, it's a place of banyan trees. And there's another story of the banyan tree from the Jataka tales, which is also very beautiful. So I was like almost focused on, I must bring the banyan tree somehow and relate to the banyan, since it is, and I don't know if you notice, even the accent, they were very clear it was Baroda and not Baroda. You know, they were very clear it was, so you have to go with the children because they will feel that, you know, this lady is able to understand. And I don't know if you noticed, they didn't ask me my name or anything. They listened to the story and they just went away. So they're not going to carry me, but they're going to carry the story. It's very important that I put my learning before me. The child should not go back and say that auntie did the voice of the lion very nicely. They should say that the story was very nice. Isn't it? That is more important. Not how I was. Right? So I think it's very important. So I'm not expecting. I didn't ask them, did you like the story? And they were the best answer I got, I thought, was they were not getting up. Yeah. You see, I had to tell them, so that's the end of the story. Isn't it? They did not get up. And I think you can't get a better answer from the children than that they are not willing to go away after the story is over. So, you don't come first, it's the learning, the teaching, the facilitating. Doesn't matter if the child doesn't remember you or your name or from where you're coming from. Right? Because you have reached out to something. So, that was one. The other thing is, when they said lion, that was the first clue I got, that when all of them said lion, I said, okay, then I'll tell them the lion and mosquito. That's when I decided that it would be the lion and the mosquito. And the additions in the story, it's a very, very simple folk tale. It is a folk tale which is very complicated when you read it. Okay, it's a complication of characters. It's a very subtle level. But how do you bring it to children? Right? So, the characters are there and mosquito nobody would like. But I have to make this child understand that the mosquito is also important, right? So from the lion, from the gross, you come to the subtle, right? So now I thought the best is to create the jungle, which is what I did only today. It's the first time I was doing the story the way I did today. So I created the jungle for them. I created the sounds of animals. And I did a lot of animals which they can relate to. So that it's not something like, you know, I don't know if you noticed, I did not tell the giraffe. It was one of the children who said, giraffe. Actually, we don't have giraffes here. So because the child said giraffe, I said, okay, let's put giraffe into the jungle. Otherwise, it's nice to relate to whatever is in our environment itself. It's very important to do that. So this is how I created the story for the children as I was looking at them. And I also paused because there was a sound, right? So it's important that I pause, and when they were ready to come back to the story. And I wanted to know whether they were following the story, so I asked them, do you remember where I left off? Yeah. So I was also relaxing in between when I was telling the story. Generally, I do not have any interruptions when I tell the story. I just tell the story. So again, it was the first time that I tried interacting in this small story to see if the child could still come back to the story. So I thought it was wonderful, and also the audience have to be receptive to it, as you said. It's wonderful that the children have. So you know so many things then about the background, the school, the education, the learning that's happening. It's a pleasure. So. But I wouldn't tell the same story in the same way again. This is a 1 year or a 2 year old. Maybe if it is a fifth and sixth standard children, I may not have too much interaction because you see they don't really express. They would sit stiff, but it doesn't mean they are not listening. But I would probably not be so comfortable in moving with them or stopping. I would probably just tell the story with a good language and good flow. So you'll have to change the story according to the problems. Yeah? So when you plan too much, as Rekha was saying, it becomes very difficult. Now, I, for instance, I did not think of East and West. I did not think of using huge and majestic. That was not in my mind at all. The main character in my story was only the lion and the mosquito. And by the way, because the children were giving me words, because they, you see, they related when I said sun. So I said, oh, okay, let me then build this up. So each component you pull and then make it a wonderful story. Went into the land of the forest, the animals. And I think it's very important, and the first thing that we learn about storytelling is what is storytelling. That's what we are going to do today. Two things that we are going to do is what is storytelling.
Hand is it? So you know, the audience sitting opposite to you, they could tell that it is
right hand.
Second was the left.
Exactly.
Even these
and they were so sensitive. I thought they were following every bit of the story. You know,
mini. What I see, teachers they do cover all these things, but little artificially by. And you're very happy. Oh, children, no right hand, left hand. What joy it gives to teacher. I don't know. Where is free time is more important for me.
Thanks.
Even what Pooja was sharing, Pooja, that we should ask what
did you learn? What is the value?
Moral of the story.
As
Ram lastly said, he's writing the story. We try to teach them. But the way you was trying, that was the total involvement of the students. I mean, it was going as they wanted. Okay. As you said, ki, you just imitated what they were saying, the words, and you just picked up and started narrating the story. That
and generally in the classroom, you just see teachers. Many children, they do reply, yeah. But they don't implement. And which hurts?
Absolutely.
Which hurts that they know what to answer, see, yeah. But they don't mean it. And what I'm trying to say is that with this kind of thing, they mean it. For the life, they will try to relate.
Yes.
And gradually, they will try to understand that nobody is big or small or anything we do. Why we say who is a king and who is. Everyone is important.
Yeah, that's enough. I think you can.
That is also very exploitation.
So, has it got any connection with the marks that you're getting about a particular subject and you're not applying what you're learning? So, it's not. That, okay, slow and steady means the race. So what? But you're not going to be slow and steady. You're going to push and go forward, right? That's what is happening today. So I think a lot of things has to be application oriented. And I agree with Geeta in one sense that unless I or you have the passion and the feeling, we have to feel it completely. Because only from passion comes compassion. Only from sympathy comes empathy. You cannot all of a sudden start, okay, in the story I'm going to bring empathy back. It can't happen. You can't suddenly bring a feeling. You can't suddenly bring an emotion. It has to be there. And we have to build it from inside. As I think it's very important that there is something which I deal with. It's called the internal aspects of the storytelling. Actually, we are going to do a little bit of that. Because unless I'm internally prepared, internally hollow, internally truthful, I cannot bring it out externally. Because I'm just wearing a sari, I'm not Aishwarya Rai or someone who's like an attractive personality in one sense. So it's not the personality, it is not how old you are or how young you are, it is not about wearing a mask. Or enacting. I'm not acting, but I am going with the story. And that's the difference between theatre and storytelling. You see, in theatre, I become that particular one character. Like, instant, I will be the lion, she will be the mosquito, he will be the snake, he will be the rabbit. And you see, the whole jungle created on the stage, right? Now, I have to remember my lines. I am the strongest. We're all prepared. The script is in place. Lights are off in the audience. So I don't even look at the audience. I'm only worried about where my position on stage is. And the light is completely on me. And I'm the focus and I'm the light. Right? Okay, so I am in that character. I stick to the lines. I enact it. I enact the line. And then my entry and exit is also all planned. Then I have a choreographer, I have a director, I have a scriptwriter, and all that. And in storytelling, I cannot tell a story
person. So all of them stood up, good morning, ma'am. I said, he stood up, thank you, ma'am. Okay? So I said, okay. So there, long ago, you know how I start the story, and I said there was this huge, big, giant, a big appetite. And I was trying to get the attention of the crowd. And you must see the children, not one movement. That's all. So I said, and I went near this boy and said, I'm. So the giant felt so hungry that he went for lunch back to his cave, and I went to the your name and what institution you are coming from. Okay.